One of the most useful and common things you're going to use in any game engine is the trigger. Now, a trigger is usually a basic object, two-dimensional or three-dimensional, and it's invisible to the player, but you set it in an editor, and when the player enters it, or some object enters it, it sends out an event. And with those events, just like in our previous functional state machines, you can trigger any number of actions and behaviors. So in games, you've seen this over and over when you enter a certain area and a cutscene will start, or you head over to a certain part of a room and a monster jumps out of a vase, or whatever that monster's jumping out of. You see this start conversations. You've seen this do all sorts of things in games. Any number of items, basically anything you can do in a game, you can fire off with a trigger. And in fact, use triggers to fire off test events while you're developing them that never make it to actual gameplay. So they're useful both during the game and during development. We're going to be using triggers a lot for the rest of these examples. So let's take a quick look at how you'd wire up a functional state machine on a basic trigger. So for this scene, I've created a quick little marker object, and it's just a cube that I've flattened. And I've put this texture on it with a red border, and that is just so we can place our trigger above it and see it while we're working over here in the game. Triggers are invisible in the game. You don't want to see them, you just want them to take action when you enter them. So this helps during testing, just to see what we're doing. So let's make that trigger. I'm going to start with a simple cube. This is just a Unity cube. And I will put it at 000, actually 010. One will leave it floating above the ground by one unit. And I'm going to scale it up to 2 by 2 by 2. And that makes it exactly the size of my little marker gizmo here. Well, it's not technically a gizmo. You know what I mean. And you can see that it's still visible. We can see the mesh here. So I'm going to choose the mesh renderer on this object, right-click on it, and choose Remove Component. And that gets rid of the physical mesh, the visible portion of it in the game. So this is just the geometric location now, just information. I'm going to activate isTrigger under Box Collider, and we have turned this simple cube into a functional trigger. So finally, I'm going to name it, and I use T underscore in my work just to know this is a trigger rather than any other object. Say test trigger. That's exactly what we're doing with it. I usually use the T underscore so I can find it later. If you've chosen something else in your scene like this, the trigger's not visible anymore and you won't be able, you know, you can click around, but you won't get it. This lets me know right away that this object is indeed a trigger and it should be invisible. And that helps me find it later in the scene. All right, let's add our FSM right to this trigger object. So with it selected, come down to your Playmaker window, add new FSM, and I'm going to call the first state listener. Because what a trigger does is it just hangs out and waits for one of its events to be true. Did anybody enter me? Did anybody exit me? Or is anybody hanging out inside of me? And when any of those things is true, it'll send out an event. And it checks every game cycle, every frame, depending how they're set up in your engine. And it'll send these events if any of those things are true. So I call this a listener just because that's kind of what it's doing. And in my action browser, I will select trigger. And here we have trigger event. That's what we want to add. Let's add one of those. Pretty simple. If you look at the trigger portion, the very top pop-up box here, click on it, we have on trigger enter, on trigger stay, and on trigger exit. Now, in this example, I'm going to use enter and exit. Let me talk about these really quick in case you're not familiar with triggers. On trigger enter simply means if anything comes within the inside bounding zone of this cube, if anybody is inside of me, then I will send out this event. Something has entered me. If something has been inside of me and exits, it will send this message, on trigger exit. So to get an exit, you have to have an enter first. Okay, if that makes sense. You can't exit it. Just like, remember we're talking about state machines. You can't turn off a light switch that's already off. You can't exit a trigger until you enter it. An onTrigger stay is kind of a special event. It means if somebody's entered me, I can check to see if they're still in, right? And it's very different from this. You could have somebody enter, say a character enters it at a particular time, and 2 minutes later, that character could exit that trigger. And then you would get two events, an enter event and an exit event, and they would be 2 minutes apart. On trigger stay, if that character enters and then hangs out, you're going to get a stay event every time the trigger checks its status. So you would use this for something like a persistent action while somebody was inside of the trigger. Maybe you want to play a sound, maybe you want to play some particle effects, maybe, you know, anything you want to have happen in your game, conditional upon being in here. Now, you can also check inside and outside for leaving, but it's a little bit different. We'll talk about this more as we go along. So for right now, I'm going to keep it on trigger enter, but I also want an on trigger exit event. So how we get that is we just add another trigger event. I'll just add a second one. And on this one, I will choose on trigger exit. So if you look in our stack, we have an enter and an exit. And for our instances here, we don't need any other anything else set on these. We can go ahead and move along. Each of these enter and exit events is going to do something different. So we're going to need two different states. Makes sense, right? And we're going to need two different events. So let's just call this entered. We'll call this exited, because that means something entered, something exited. And let's set those up in the listener. Now we're going to need two transitions, right? Because we have two events that could possibly be true here. So on the first one, custom event, entered, custom event, exited, just showing you can get them down here as well as right up there. And I'm going to wire each of these to that state. Okay, entered state, and let's go ahead and name that since we're doing it. And exit. Easy as that. Now, the last thing to do is on our trigger events, for each send event object, on the enter, on the on trigger enter, we're going to set that to send the entered event. And the on trigger exit trigger event, we're going to set to the exited event. All right, now each of these will have a transition as well when they're done. Let's add a finished to each of these. And that finished can flow right back into the listener. Whoops, my mistake. And there we go. So if something enters this trigger, it'll flow, fire this event, and it'll flow into the enter event. We'll do whatever we want to do when something enters the trigger. And when that's done, when that's finished, we'll send right back into the listener and we'll continue to listen. So there'll be a brief moment when we pass out through here when we're not paying attention to events in the trigger. But otherwise, we're pretty solid. Same thing here for exited. We're going to flow in, flow back out. Now, this is much like turning on the light switch or opening the chest, any of those sorts of actions. In this case, I'm going to start, so we can test our little state machine, by just changing some text. You can see I have here, not in trigger. That is part of my GUI text object right here. This is my basic text. I've labeled it not in trigger because when you start the game, you're not going to be in the trigger. I thought that made a lot of sense. So let's change, right here in the action browser, let's pick the enter. Let's change that with a very simple action. So if we type in GUI text, oops, helps if you spell it right. And we want to set GUI text. There it is at the top. Now, looking in our set GUI text action, we don't want to use the owner because the owner is actually the trigger right here. It's not the GUI text object. This is the object we want to reach. So let's specify game object. And if you click and drag, put it right there in that box, and we've connected it. And since we've entered the trigger, I'm going to have it change the text to in trigger. And we don't need to do this every frame. We can just change it once and we're done. So once again, what happens if somebody enters the trigger? It's going to go into this event, really quickly change the text, and when it's done, flow right back into the listener to wait for another event, presumably the exit event. And on that exit event, let's go ahead and set up the text to set that back. Once again, GUI text, set GUI text. And the same thing here, we can specify the object, drag it in, and we'll put it back to not in trigger. Easy as that. All right, let's fire this up and see if our little masterpiece is working. Play the game, and if I move forward into the trigger, see it says not in trigger, right up there on the text. If I move in trigger, and you can see that on the screen on our right, that our little first-person controller capsule is indeed inside. And we pull back out, not in trigger. There we go. We can see the states flowing around as I enter and exit. Changes our text. Nice and easy, just like we want. All right, for the last step, I'm going to have it also play a sound when I enter and exit the trigger. So let's choose the enter event again. Go to the action browser. Sorry, the enter state, not the enter event. And in the action browser, I'm going to choose play sound. Just like we played an animation, except we're going to play a sound. And once again, we need to drag something into this audio clip section. And I happen to have a couple of audio files in here. So I'll take Bell High. Whoops. There we go. Sometimes it hops off. I'm going to change my view a little bit to, whoops, wiring view so I get a little better look. Drag that right in there. And over here on the exit, I'm going to do the same thing. Add. Whoops. Get up in that box. Whoops. There we go. Play sound. And this time we'll use the bell low. Let's go back to first layout. And let's play the game and see what we get. And there we go. We've got the sound being played when we enter and exit the trigger. Oh, enter, in trigger, exit trigger. And there's our two sounds. So, triggers. Pretty quick to set up. Very, very useful. They do all sorts of things for us, and we're going to put these to much better use as we go along. But this was a good introduction. Feel free to play with these a little bit if they don't make sense yet, because triggers are one of the major pillars of game design. You're going to use these all over the place, 2D and 3D games. So get comfortable with them if you're not yet, and then let's move on.